nothing fake. Be who you wanna be, 'cause what makes you unique is your identity.
It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity. It's your identity. Yeah. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity. It's your identity. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity. It's your identity. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity. It's your identity.
Okay, we are live. Welcome. I am excited about tonight's segment for the Other Woman magazine, Peeling Back the Layers with Miss Meredith Kilmartin. We spoke for the very first time tonight while we were testing equipment, and I asked her how she was doing, and she said, "I am striving and thriving." And I was like, "Yes, girl, you go." So I don't know a lot about Meredith. I know that she has a passion, a desire, a dream to become a performer, entertainer. And her mother and I went to high school together in Montgomery, Alabama, George Washington Carver. And I saw a picture of Meredith on Facebook, and I was curious about how she planned on breaking into this oversaturated world of entertainment. So we're going to peel back some layers with Meredith tonight. And without further ado, I am going to bring her on. Let me see if I can do this. I should be ashamed of myself. It should be really easy by now. Hey!
Hello, hello!
Miss Striving and Thriving. That is what you said, right? Striving and thriving?
I'm striving and thriving.
Well, thank you and welcome to the Other Woman magazine, Peeling Back the Layers.
Thank you for having me.
I want you to just be comfortable and feel at home. It is showtime. I'm sure you've heard that before. And I'm going to allow you to introduce yourself. Just share just a little bit about yourself.
Absolutely. Hello, everyone. My name is Meredith Kilmartin. I am currently, as Lavender said, I am trying to break into the entertainment industry, and I'm currently actually studying musical theater at West Virginia University. Let's go Mountaineers.
Okay, so you're studying music and theater, you said?
Yes, musical theater. So just a
musical
little bit
theater.
More song compared to doing actual scenes.
Okay, so you didn't choose a traditional career. You chose something that is very difficult to break into, something that is not easy and almost a who you know field. Why entertainment? Why performer?
It is honestly one of those things that a lot of actors and working actors say when everyone asks them, "Hey, what should you say to someone who wants to be in entertainment?" They almost always say, "Don't do it," because it's not easy. It's not like walking up to Indeed.com and putting in a job application, and then hopefully after enough applications go out, you get hired. For me, theater and performance chose me. thought about it throughout my entire life. Ever since I was little, my mother will tell you that I was putting on little plays for people who came over and for dinner, for dad's business meetings. I would drag everyone into my room to watch a play about a children's book. And I do like 7 costume changes. But there is one specific moment in my brain that is just, this is what I want to do. I was very fortunate at the age of 7 while we were living in the valley area of Northern California to get to see Wicked on the national tour when I was about 7.
Okay.
And first of all, the show is amazing. There's a reason why it's been running for so long. But what I distinctly remember and what I wrote all my college essays about, right after the show, I remember looking around at the audience members and how much the show moved them and how much it changed them. And I remember looking at my mom and going, I want to do that. I want to take just the time and like let people get away from the stress of their real lives and just look at something. And maybe they learn something either about the world or about themselves, and it changes them. And for me, of course, there are tons of ways to change people. But ever since then, it's been like, how can I move you like I move those actors who moved me on stage and the other crowd?
Wow. And you were 7?
I was 7 years old. And right after the show, part of why it's such a core memory for me as a performer is that I begged my mom to buy me the cast album. And I went home and I listened to all of it. And I remember trying my best to do the blocking, the stage direction they did on stage in my bedroom. And I did that I think, for a solid week straight before I did anything else.
Wow. Well, you said something key. You didn't choose performing and entertainment. It chose you. And I usually tell people that about me as a writer. I didn't just set out and say, okay, what do I want to do? I want to be a writer. It was in my blood. It's obviously in your blood. And when you hear stories of successful actors and actresses, they usually say, they give a story similar to what you just shared. And you're how old right now?
I am 21 years of age.
Good Lord. So you know what? You're a baby. And do you feel like you started early, or is in the entertainment world, did you start late?
In some aspects, I started really early. And in some aspects, I started really late. It depends on who you ask. I, for one, have been dancing and putting on little shows since I was around 2 years old, but I didn't start vocal training until my senior year of high school, which if you tell some people, you tell that to, they're like, well, you're already too late, but that's not going to, negative feelings aren't going to get you anywhere. So you just kind of have to push that aside and go, okay, this is not helpful. I'm going to continue on the path I am. And in other ways, I'm ahead of the game. I enjoy nowhere near to the level you're writing, but I do some playwriting and I do some children's theater work. It's just kind of different for everyone. No one's journey looks exactly the same.
Right. So you have been busy pretty much. I can say you've been a producer since 7 years old. You've been producing your own.
Yes, I have. The Busy Theater of Meredith Kilmartin is always...
Okay, so if it's in your blood, let's talk about your family. Is anyone else in the industry that you know of?
Off the top of my head, no one is physically in the acting industry quite like I am. But I think part of where I get my musical love and my musical like bloodbornness in my life is from my father. My father was a musician in college. That's how he partially paid for college. He was in a band, I believe, that was called The Spare Parts. With his friends. And I remember even as a kid, him just playing this big grand piano in our living room and just dancing the night away.
Wow. And you probably were there dancing right along with him, or how?
Just dancing right along with him. I think I was dancing before I even came out my mama. It's just... I've always been a mover, and anyone you meet, even if they don't know me as an actor, will tell you Meredith moves a lot. She has a real hard time standing still, and it's true.
So speaking of standing still, you just got back from New York. You're in Virginia right now, right?
I'm in West Bagot, Virginia, but that's what we call here.
Okay. Network, did it have anything to do with your dream, making your dream come true?
I did. I am so grateful. I received an amazing opportunity to be performing with a company called RWS. And I got to work as a performer full-time over the summer at an amusement park up in upstate New York. And I got to meet some amazing people. I get to make lots of connections. I learned a lot more about the industry and a lot more about myself. So it was a very successful trip, and I'm so grateful for the people I got to interact with directly and indirectly. It's just amazing. And for some people, I think when they hear, oh, you worked at a theme park, for me, it's, hey, someone paid me to be on stage 4 to 5 times a day. And it's all about those little baby steps. And for me, this is a huge milestone. And I'm so grateful to how I got to reach that, to an audition held here at my university, organized by an old professor whom I adore. And it's just, I got very lucky and I'm so grateful.
That's wonderful. And I must say, you are very well spoken for 21 years old. You know, you sound like you've got the plan. You're on your journey. Let me ask you this. Are there any reservations, any doubts, any insecurities about the whole pursuit that you have, that you're fighting?
I think yes. The simple answer is yes. And the long answer is there is something in your body, at least for me, that's telling you, like, this is not a very, as you mentioned, it's a very oversaturated career path. It is, everyone's like wanting to be an actor on TV. Even you see like the struggling actor portrayed as someone who is oftentimes miserable and just like not enjoying it. But there's something in the love for me and for everyone who has ever been any sort of successful in this industry, where it's like, I love this more than I fear this. You have to love it more. And it's okay to come back into phases in and out of that. There was a time about a year and a half ago, I would have told you, I'm done. I'm ready to quit because I was losing the joy. But just like everything in life, you have to find the joy. And sometimes it's making the joy for yourself.
And how do you do that? How do you make that joy? Talk about those days or that day that you remember with that you wanted to say, it's over, I'm finished. How did you find that joy to continue on?
Sometimes for me, I did go through like a little bit of a funk that they were just like, well, I should keep doing this because I know down deep that this is what's for me. This is who I am. And I think there is somewhat of a danger in that. I'm not saying that you should make performing and entertaining your entire personality. You'll just burn yourself straight to the wick, down to the bottom of the candle. But you just kind of have to remember, why did I start doing this? I didn't start doing this because I wanted to be famous or I wanted to be a big name. Of course, everyone would enjoy that. I'm not trying to say I'll deter that. If anyone would like to make me famous, I would happily take that. It's a lot. But I did it because it's fun. You just have to remember, like, it's not just a job. Because for me, this started as a hobby. And my hobby just happened to become, hopefully, my career. You just have to look back, as you just said, like, remember those moments. And sometimes I go through messages people have sent me, friends, my family, colleagues, mentors, and just remember that sometimes it's okay not to believe in yourself all the time.
Right.
Because it's hard. But having that support system around you that is there to rally behind you, even in your darkest moment, is what helps you drive forward.
And you obviously have a strong support within your family. Now, I know some young people who might want to go that route and, you know, be a actress or a singer, and the parents will say, you know, you need to get an education. You need to go find a real job, something that you can be gainfully employed. What would you tell some parents, think about yourself? It's in your gut. there's nothing else that you want to do but perform and entertain. You know that this is what you were born for. If your parents said, no, Meredith, you need to go find something else to major in. You need to be a teacher, a doctor, a lawyer. You need to find some security. What would you tell your parents or parents of some young person who was trying to pursue?
I think it's a really hard question because I understand those parents' fears. I understand my parents, both my mother and my father and my brother and my dog are very supportive, and my fish are very supportive of what I am doing. But I understand that they're afraid for me. All I think most parents want for their children is for them to be happy and successful. Right. And a lot of people know that this is really hard. And I think conversations I have sometimes with my own parents and I've seen my peers have with their parents is, I know it's scary and I know you want what's best for me. But right now, I'm an adult and I really think that this is what is best for me. Mm-hmm. And I understand if you don't support that. I understand that people get scared, but it's just kind of one of those things where even if you don't have a family that's not supportive, if you are an entertainer and you don't have this family that's unsupportive, I'm sorry about that. I really am. I know it's a ton harder and I'm very grateful that right now I'm not experiencing that. But know that if you have that strong enough gut feeling in your belly that this is for you, you can make that happen. It might be a lot harder. I know it's going to be a lot harder, but just really pushing yourself and being your biggest believer and writing, sometimes you have to be your support system, which is really hard.
That's good. That was an excellent, excellent answer. You are 21, you're starting on this journey, and you said, what's best for me right now? I'm an adult. This is the route I have to take. Are you supporting yourself or are your parents helping you right now?
I am very fortunate to be receiving a lot of help from my parents. Okay. And I think sometimes I take that for granted and I really regret that. But I am so grateful to have not only their moral support, but they're treating me as an investment. And I understand why they get so worried. They're like, we're investing in you. We want to see you turn out the way you are. So It's not necessarily so easy to go pull back and pull forward. It's not a clean cut answer. And my answer will not be an answer for everyone. That's not fair. Everyone's story is different. But it's always a balance of remembering who's supporting you both mentally, physically, and emotionally.
Trying to
move forward.
And I think your family will appreciate hearing that. Do you feel pressure to succeed because they are investing? I think about Shark Tank when you said they're investing. People who invest believe in you. Those sharks are not going to make an investment on anybody who they don't believe that can make it. So your parents who are investing in you, they believe you can make it. Is there pressure on you to be successful?
Yeah, there's just like no like neat way to put a bow on that. I feel pressure from, not in a bad way though. I don't want to make it sound like, and they're like, if you're not successful, disowned. It's not like that at all.
Right.
It's like, again, they want what's best for me. And I think that, again, what's what all parents want. There is a pressure to succeed and hit certain milestones, I think. But there's also that pressure I get from myself. I want to keep pushing myself to get better. And I want to constantly be improving. And sometimes that does get in that little hamster on a hamster wheel, just going in a cycle. You're like, well, I'm going to burn myself out.
Yeah. But
just remember, I think, so sorry. Just remember that they are.
Those are your fans.
Those are my fans. You're my roommate. it's just kind of remembering, just like there's that pressure that they give you, it's that there's a pressure, but they believe in you. Otherwise, they wouldn't put a grain of worth in this. It's a to and fro, balancing act, I think.
Right, exactly. And you know what, as a parent myself, I know I have my oldest son served 6-7 years in the Army, and he wanted to get out because he has two sons. So the average thinker would say, no, you need to stay in for security for your children. But I supported him because he felt like there was more in him to give. He felt like there was a life outside of the military that he needed to pursue. So I supported him. Of course, it was always in the back of my mind. Okay, I'm supporting you. I'm believing in you. But you're responsible for this life you created, you know, your children, your sons. And he's doing greater than I expected. So it goes back to what you said, Meredith. You have to believe in yourself, in your gut. You know that this is the journey that you're supposed to be on. So I applaud you, because a lot of people run away from their dreams because they seem too big. But I was told a long time ago, if you're going to think at all, don't think small. You got to think big, you know, so I'm sure you encourage yourself a lot. What are you doing right now? What are you involved in right now?
So right now I am currently back in school. I got here about a week ago. And I'm very fortunate and blessed to be cast in a play that's happening.
Wonderful.
November and beginning of December with the university. And it's called Skryker by Carol Churchill. It's a very interesting play.
And okay.
I'm really excited about being in school, because you get to do all these artier plays that aren't necessarily so commercially successful.
Right.
It's so exciting. We're also on an entirely female non-binary production team and cast, and it's just really exciting to see that, especially with the field being very male dominant.
That sounds exciting. Now I'm going to show some pictures that I stole off of your, no, actually you sent me these pictures, but I have been all over your Facebook page.
I'm so excited to see what pops up.
Looking all over your page. Okay. I'm going to share some pictures and you just tell me what's going on here. Okay. What is this one about? That's cute. You have no shame. You are not, I could never. You are like, here I am, world.
Here I am. What is this about? This is actually my very first production at WVU. It was for a good friend and former roommate of mine, Joseph Kemprowski, who is based in Pennsylvania and also is a working actor, director. They are just so amazing. And they he was doing a play, and he wanted to add this dance break to the end of it because it's kind of set in the 80s. And he's like, Meredith, do you want to do this? And I'm like, hell yeah, I want to do this. Get me up there. And that is, these are my friends and classmates. Celia Dahl is there on the left, and on the right is Becca Hyde. And we are dancing to Whitney Houston's So Emotional.
Right. Okay. There. Okay, that'll get you moving.
Moving and grooving, shaking.
And this is at West Virginia.
Yes, in our very own VDM Black Box Theater.
Okay, so how many years? What are you, a?
I'm a senior right now, and this is from my first semester freshman year. Wow. And I remember thinking, if there's any proof that you just have to take the small victories, I believe opening night there were 2 people in the audience.
That is great. That's going to be a story for you to share. Mm-hmm. For some young people who are going to be in your position one day, you can share. How many people? 2 people?
2 people, and I'm pretty sure that they were part of freshman seminar and had to see theater productions to pass the class. And it's just such a sweet memory that I have in my brain.
That is funny. Okay, here's another one.
Oh, this is from 2018. It's the summer in between my junior and senior year of high school. And this is from Westfield Summer Stages production of Hairspray.
Okay.
Which is a Westfield Summer Stage. Westfield High School is a high school in the area that I'm from. And over the summer, they hold just a county, I guess statewide, I guess anyone could have shown up to audition to be in their production. It was my first lead role in a musical.
Wow.
And
wow. You can't go wrong with Hairspray. Cannot go wrong.
Can't go wrong. And that was one of my favorite shows. Oh, that was in a local newspaper. That is Mr. John Henry Stamper, very talented actor who I believe is going to Arizona State University for musical theater. Very talented. And the funny story about Hairspray is that my mother, who I can see is typing in our chat, had sent me to this audition to fail. She wanted me to go and wanted me to not get it. She was like, you need to learn this industry is full of failure. You're going to get way more no's than you're going to get yeses. And I'm so grateful for that lesson, but also, unfortunately, the lesson was not taught here. I got it. And I'm so grateful. And that was directed by Rachel Harrington and choreographed by Jonathan Fairgood.
You are very good and given credit and calling those names. You go, girl. Is that something they teach you?
It is. I guess it's kind of taught, but it's just kind of like respecting the people you work with. It's kind of like, for me, this is also just like a milestone in my career getting to be here and talk with you. It's just like, why don't I share the wealth? Because when I succeed, everyone else gets to succeed too. So,
girl, that sounds good. So when you're on the big screen, don't forget about the Other Woman magazine. Okay.
I will not.
Okay, here's another one.
Oh, this is from I did a Christmas Carol with Rooftop Productions in Manassas, Virginia. And there we go. We got Leland Shook there. And my wonderful kids, I was playing Mrs. Cratchit along with some other roles in this show.
That look on your face, my goodness.
I don't know what was happening. I'm pretty sure this was also for a local newspaper. And I think in the moment I was acting like, kids, be quiet. There's someone important here. There's Scrooge is at the door. I need everyone to calm down. And of course, that's the picture that made in the magazine, not the newspaper. And I'm just like, great.
Oh, gosh, that is funny. Okay, here's another one.
This is from last semester in a production of 35 Millimeter, which is a song cycle musical written by Ryan Scott Oliver. And I was so fortunate and lucky to be cast as a swing or an understudy for two of the actors. There aren't names in this show, so I was like following actor 5 and 6. And I got to work as the wonderful Miss Sun on piano, one of the most brilliant piano players I've ever met in my entire life. That was directed by Matthew Greenberg, a beloved former professor of mine who's currently in Wyoming teaching there. And I'm trying to see, there's Drew Gassemi, that's one of the people I covered for, and Josie Miller, a classmate of mine, Annalise Edwards, Mackenzie Wolcott, Noah Grossman, Michael Gilligan, Christian Klausenser, and Clayton Muir. And that was stage managed by the lovely Sunny Rollinson.
What year was this, Mary?
This was last year, so end of 2021. And that, oh my gosh, that was almost a year ago that show went up.
And you remember the names of everyone.
I do my best. I probably won't remember everyone's names, but that's just because I'm a little flittery. I did have some coffee today, so hopefully I'll remember everyone. This is from a production of Sonnets for an Old Century, which we did last spring at the beginning of March, which is a collection of sonnets of people kind of stuck in this in-between. It's your last time to say anything before you go off into the ether. We don't like describing purgatory, but there we go. We got Sydney Penna, we got Tyler Morrison, Sam Mumbai, Natalia, Eli Nygaard, Chidera, Paxton, Mathen, Anthony, Javen Buchanan, and Claudia. And that was directed by the lovely Miss Irene Albee, and had a production team including Brandon Russi and a good friend of mine, Katie. it was just a wonderful experience. And we actually spent the first 2 weeks of rehearsal walking in a circle. And that was all about learning how to listen to each other. And I won't lie, at the time I was like, why are we doing this? This seems like such a waste of time. And I was looking at Irene, I'm like, Irene, you're crazy. Why are we doing this? And oh my God, it paid off. And there's always a method to the madness. It's
since
always
walking in a circle, huh? Wow. Now this, I say this for last because this was my favorite one. Honey, you look like you are just having a ball.
I was. That was a wonderful production. Again, with Westfield Summer Stage, again, directed by Rachel Harrington and choreographed by Jonathan Fairgood. I am playing Madame Thénardier in Les Misérables.
Say that again.
Les Misérables.
Okay. Probably
you speak French. I'm so sorry. And this is just at the very end scene where me and my husband, Monsieur Thénardier, played by a very good friend of mine from high school, Jeffrey Mortson, have broken into this party to try and rob all these rich people. They're not good people, but they're funny.
Oh my gosh. Oh my goodness. You know what? Someone else is saying how good at names that you are. And when I asked if you were taught, your mother came in and said, your mother taught you.
Mama's my momager. She's.
And I knew that. You were raised well when you mentioned being respectable, and I know you won't forget that. I have no doubt that I'm going to see you on the big screen one day. So I am so proud of you for your perseverance and just your drive and your passion. Let me ask you, are there any actors or performers that you, let's see, I don't want to say pattern yourself. Who are your favorites? Who are your favorite actors and actresses?
Oh, this is where you're going to realize I'm bad at names. This is where we get to the point where I'm like, that lady did that thing. I am far more in the world of live entertainment, specifically Broadway. If I had if someone asked me point blank, what's your big dream? I'd be like, well, Broadway or the West End in England would be wonderful. An actor I really look up to and admire probably musically is Emma Hunton. I know her well from when she's on the cast recording for Freaky Friday, the musical, based off. Classic. And she's also in one of my favorite musicals I'm actually working on a scene for class right now called The Mad Ones, or The Unauthorized Biography of Samantha Brown. Her voice and the timbre in her voice reminds me of her, and the way that she plays characters is very much like similar to my type. And just kind of fits in there. I'm trying to think of other people. Katie Rockwell, who is in Mean Girls, I think she kind of plays these ditzy characters a lot, but she is so smart in how she acts. And going off, this is such a weird turn. There is a show that is no longer on anymore called Switched at Birth, which follows one of my second passions, but I'm far behind there, American Sign Language. And there is an actress there. She's, I believe, the first actress who ever won, deaf actress who won an Oscar. And she is just so talented. I mean, mm-hmm. I have this amazing ability that sometimes I overlook, that I get to act with my voice. There's like this way that she can act without her voice, but you can still hear and feel everything saying. It's just amazing. And I mean, of course, I could go on. Like Christian Chenoweth is hilariously funny. Idina Menzel is wonderful. But really, I honestly admire like people I work with on the day to day. I am so fortunate to be in a class of a cohort of 10 other amazing actors and actresses, and I get to watch them grow and thrive every day. And it's just amazing to watch everyone else's journeys. Of course, it's harder to look back on your journey when you're around that, but it's just like, Right. Well, we're all together. We're the strong unit and we're growing. And it's just really cool, because I think one of the things they do teach you from the very beginning is you're never done learning. And that's just true in life. But
yes, it is.
it's not like, okay, I got my business degree, I'm done. It's like, okay, I'm done taking class at university. I've got this nice fancy piece of paper that costs so much money. But it's also like, okay, I'm going to go take a class here now. I'm going to go take a dance class at the local dance studio. So there's always continual learning, I think.
You are, I don't want to say you found the other woman because you're 21 years old, but you're well on your way. The other woman is that woman inside all of us who is usually silenced or suppressed or unable to just be free to be who she is because of fear of failure or fear of judgment or because of religion or upbringing. She just lets it go. And I love the word unapologetically. That's who you are, Meredith. And don't ever change, because there are women in their 70s and 80s who have not found the other woman, who haven't found their voice. And you're just an example of that. So as you continue on your career, your journey to your career, you remind other women to be free, to be who they are and to pursue their dreams and to live their lives unapologetically, because I believe once you arrive, as it seems like you have, going after what you want with the one life you have, we have an obligation to let other women know that, because we live our lives for our families, our husbands, our children. Girl, you're free now. You're not married. You don't have any children. You get it all, honey. Get it all in before you fall in love, and then bing.
Well, then my life's over. I'm in love. No, and I think it's important that I really appreciate what you just said to me. It really means a lot. But I think it's also important to realize that sometimes I'm not, and it's okay. It's okay to take little pauses back for you to figure out who that other woman is and to just enjoy. For me, I understand, like, this is my one life, as far as I know. I don't know any secrets that anyone else does. If anyone else has any secrets, they will take them. But for me, I want to say I don't take life seriously, because I do, but it is just kind of like, for all I know, this is my one chance at doing things. Why would I ever settle for anything less? Why not at least try? Just give it a best try.
At least try. Yes, I am so full right now listening to you and just grateful that I was able to meet you. And I will be replaying this video, and I will also be sharing it on the Other Woman magazine website, and just hoping that it will be beneficial to not only young people but to older women and men. What is your dream job? If someone knocked on your door right now, you answer the door, "Hi, I'm Mrs. Dream or Mr. Dream." You're too young to remember the show I Dream of Jeannie. You don't know that show.
I know of it. I have not personally seen any episodes, but I know my aunt and my aunt Kim. Hi, Kim, if you're watching. And Aunt Ginger, if you're watching, they love that show, and I've heard them talk.
Okay, so Jeannie comes to your door and your wish is her command. Is that how you say it? Yeah, my wish is your command. What would your wish be? What's your dream job?
My dream job. I think, again, going back to that overarching dream, for me, TV and television, same thing. TV and film is wonderful, and it is so important. I love that we're starting to see other people's voices come, and now that we have such a diversified way of sharing media, we get to see all that. For me, there is nothing quite like live theater. There just isn't.
Quite like what?
Live theater. So, like,
okay,
walking in, seeing a play, even if it's like the play from that high school down the street, it's just something magic, because there's no do-over. It's just like what happens, and it's going to be a little different every night. But if someone asked me what dream I would like to be, I would love to be on Broadway.
Broadway. I knew you were going to say Broadway.
I would love to be on Broadway. I would love to headline a show if we're going to get like a really steep wish. But I think part of what I've learned – growing and getting to be in a wonderful program that we have at West Virginia University, is that you can have a really big dream. And even if you don't achieve that really big dream, you have to look back on your other successes. So it's like, hey, I worked all summer in performance, or hey, I wrote a show. Hey, I did really well in this one class I did. It's right. Just always keep looking forward. I'm not saying give up on your big dreams, but it's okay to have little dreams. That it's like a side dish in a meal. I'm not just going to eat a steak. That's boring. I need mashed potatoes. I need Brussels sprouts. I need broccoli. I need a nice
water.
Glass of wine.
Exactly.
I'm 21. Sorry, Mom.
You're 21 now. You are 21. Grab you a glass of wine.
I earned it.
So you're, is this your Aunt Lisa who's saying you just made me feel, oh, she's never seen Jeannie. She's never seen I Dream of Jeannie. So Lisa, you need to go and Google I Dream of Jeannie so you can watch her. Okay. You know what, Meredith, there is a, what's the name of that show? The American Idols and all of those reality shows. Have you ever thought about any of those? That's not the route you want.
It is something I definitely think about. For me, and what every actor will tell you, I love performing. I hate auditioning. No okay. one likes the process of trying to get the job.
Right.
It's glorious, and you're trying to guess what they're thinking, which is really hard. And you're trying to be what they want, which is just not going to happen. You just have to be you and hope that that's what they're looking for. I have definitely thought about it. I'm not sure I'm in that place where I have enough confidence in myself to put myself that vulnerable place in front of all those people. But I think it is a possibility. I don't want to say no to anything. Anything could happen. For all I know, tomorrow I wake up and I decide I want to be an actuary. I really don't think that's going to happen, but maybe.
Right. Well, you know what? You just said something. You said you didn't know if you had the confidence. When I was about to go live, I mentioned to you how I get nervous every time I go live. I do this platform because it helps my business. It helps the other woman, and it helps the women and men that I interview. But if I had a choice, I'd be behind my laptop where nobody could see me. But this is part of the job. So do you get nervous when you are not just auditioning, but when you're performing? Because you look like you're very comfortable in front of the camera. Very comfortable. And by the way, you're very pretty.
Thank you. Thanks to my mom and my daddy. I think there's always going to be that nerve. Right now, even in class, we're working on preparing different audition cuts for things. Right now, it's pop rock, which is not my favorite, but we're working on it. That's always what's important. But I think it's always nerve-wracking. You're walking into a room and being like, please like how I sing. Please like how I act. Please give me a job. And I think there's always going to be some nerves from that because, you know, most of acting, unless you are on a big TV show like Switched at Birth or Jane the Virgin or Gilmore Girls, you don't necessarily have that job security. So you're always looking for the next thing. You always have to be looking 10 steps forward. So I definitely feel nervous auditioning. Performing, hopefully you've had a really nice rehearsal process. And maybe that first night you get those little jitters in your tummy, but that's also just really healthy. Because if you don't have that anxiety, and not anxiety, that nervousness in the air, then you're not relaxed. And that means you're not listening. You have to listen to everyone while you're performing. So it's there a little bit when performing, but hopefully by that point in the process, I am confident in making strong choices and know kind of what's going to be happening next.
Okay. Good answer. Good answer. You are very easy to interview. I feel like we're just sitting having tea and a chat. What was today like for you? Because as a performer, entertainer, their days are full. full days, full nights, rehearsals, on stage. I'm talking like I know, I just know what I see and what I've read. What was today like for you, and what is the normal day for you?
So the normal day for me right now, which is about to change in about 2 weeks, is I'm very lucky that I am, not, I don't want to say it like that. I am in a show that starts the rehearsal process a little bit later into the semester, which means I do get a little bit of this free time after classes. But right now I'm getting up around 6 a.m, which is just because I need to get moving. Got to get up, got to keep going.
Are you a morning person?
I wish I really was. I really wish I was. But I'm going to have to be. Like, I'm going to be today. It's like, well, I'm not. But you're going to be one today. Yeah. And I start my days in theater text analysis with Professor Jay Malarche. And that's getting there around 9 a.m, usually around 8:45. I am battling traffic because I'm usually running late.
What's that first name you used?
Jay Malarche.
What was the name? Was that the name of the class that you were mentioning? It's
text analysis, as best I understand it. So we're reading through plays. Like today we were discussing The Rover by Aphra Behn. She was the first female playwright in England during the Restoration period, and kind of the first professional female playwright.
Okay.
And
so
go
it's a lot
there.
Of history in your schooling.
It's definitely some history, because as much as you can be like training all the time, training, keep going, you're not going to be able to move forward unless you learn from the people who've come before you. And that's just true in everything. And then usually if I'm rehearsing with a certain person for either a scene for either my studio cohort class or something we call scene study, which happens 4 times a semester and is so stressful. it's so, we have one coming up on Friday and I'm just like, oh, I'm like, I really want this to go well. So we'll do some rehearsals there. Right now I get to come home and make food. I'm trying to be way better about cooking for myself as opposed to the easy option of being like, well, it's right there. They make the food for you.
Let's right. So convenient. Too convenient. Yeah.
Too convenient. I'm just kind of like, can you all actually just like ban me from these restaurants? I would not like to come in. Please do not serve me. I usually go over some music. I'm very lucky that my roommate's old roommate left their keyboard in our apartment, and now it is my keyboard that
okay,
I
cool.
play on.
That
run
works.
Some stuff, and then I
so
head in.
Play?
Play is a very generous term. I can read music a lot better than when I started here, and I can pluck out my melody lines, just the line that you sing, and I can play some chords on piano, but once you start getting into like add a fourth, add a seventh, add a diminished, I'm like, call someone
okay.
else for me.
Okay.
And then I go to on Mondays and Wednesdays my about how long is that class? 4 hours? 4 hour class that's split in the
oh
two.
Oh my.
First half right now is Shakespeare with Mr. Cornell Gabara, who's currently performing in Shakespeare in the Park in Pittsburgh as Puck.
Oh, wow.
Right now we're going through Hamlet. So today we're reading through it. And then he says, stop, tell me what just happened. And we all sit there for 5 minutes going, hold on, let me look up about 7 words and figure out what we're saying. And then we go into singing and acting with Ryan Scoble, who is our new professor of musical theater here at West Virginia. We are loving him. We are so happy he is here.
Girl, you are good with naming those names. You are dropping names like I don't know what. Yeah.
I'll drop them everywhere. Like everything else.
Give her a lead role. Give her whatever she wants.
Listen, I'm also here for sponsorships. If you want me to sponsor your product, I'll drop it in everywhere. Today we actually didn't have to, but it was really strongly suggested that we stay an hour after to work with our pianist with the class, to work on our scenes that we're presenting on Friday.
Okay.
Which is where we present these scenes 4 times a semester with no help from faculty. It's
wow.
trying to help you how do you coach yourself? Which is really hard. It's really wow. nice when someone will just tell you, you're doing this wrong. Instead, you have to try and fix it.
So how does your day end? How does your day end? You're finished with all of your classes. You get back to your room. What do you do? Exhale.
I take a breath. I usually will, while I still have that momentum, try to go through music again just upstairs in my room. But then I try to separate my two lives somewhat. Because okay. yes, this is my passion. But if I were doing this all the time and became my entire life,
burnout
anywhere. So you'll often find me painting rocks.
Okay, put that closer. Hold on a second. Let me bring you in.
Painting rocks.
Okay. Is that something that you just like to do?
Yeah, I love arts and crafts. And it's just kind of nice to have a hobby that is artistic, that isn't like, well, if I don't do this right.
Hold the white one up again. Oh, I like that. Purple's my favorite color. Oh, I like that. Okay.
And I'll paint like little pictures sometimes. And it's not like it's nice because it's not like I have to try and be the best or try to be the best of this I can be. It's just kind of like very much like Bob Ross says in his little painting lessons, we're painting little happy trees. And it doesn't matter how good you are. You're just going to enjoy the moment. I watch a lot of YouTube videos of people that like have nothing to do with theater. Like I watch a lot of Drag Race content. I watch a lot of video game content, which is weird. I don't play a lot of video games. I wish I did, but I don't. And that's why I try my best to have somewhat of a social life. However, in 2 weeks, everything will change because we start the rehearsal process for Skryker, which will involve rehearsing 6 days a week. On weekdays 6 to 11 p.m. and then on Saturdays from noon to 6 p.m.
You do have a very busy life. Okay, let me ask you, we're going to fast forward, let's say 20-30 years. Do you have mm-hmm. a desire to marry and have children?
I do. Okay. I'm not gonna put my whole worth on that, but it's something I've just like this is just kind of like, I think, well, I hope I'd be a good mom. I really have always had like a...
Oh, definitely. You know what? You come from a good mom.
I do. I'm very
you good. Know, the seed is there. No doubt. And is there, I don't know where this question came from. What's your ideal man? Or do you even know yet? You're kind of young.
An ideal man. I'm not sure I really know. Whenever anyone asks me what my type is, I go, you know, Shaggy from Scooby-Doo?
Yeah, girl, stop it.
I know, but it is just kind of like, yeah, but also I'm 21 years old and that's most people I'm around right now. So it means college.
You said Shaggy from Scooby-Doo.
I'll come back to home in like 40 years. I know
he
it.
He may have been the sweetest guy.
He was so
sweetest
sweet.
Guy.
So sweet.
So,
my mom would say,
don't listen to the judgments of other people. If you listen to me, you'll be by yourself. So
no, and I'm trying to come, a part of what does worry me is that I am hoping, at least from my experience, constantly moving, constantly shaking, moving and shaking. And it looks like, and hopefully, because I want to be successful, my career involves a lot of traveling. So I think that worries me a little bit, but also I'm trying to remember my mentality of like, enjoy the moment.
Yes.
The moment.
Yes.
You can change the future, but you can't change the future by worrying about it.
So. Exactly. Exactly. And you're the man of your dreams, your husband, he's waiting for you somewhere on your journey. So you will definitely find him. There are plenty of actresses and actors who are happily married and have successful lives. So with the way you think and your drive and your faith, there's just no doubt you're going to have it all. You just believe that. Believe that like you believe you're going to make it, you know? Yes. Okay, so we have just 4 minutes. I want you to share... Now, I'm going to ask you something that you're probably curse in your head. You won't let me know. I'm just going to ask.
Oh, no.
If someone asked you to sing on the spot, would you do it?
I could do that, maybe. You can do that, maybe. You watch the color of my face go. Yeah, we could do that.
Okay, I'm gonna let you, we got 2 minutes. I'm gonna let you share a few words with some aspiring entertainers, performers. Say a few words and then end with a song. Or it doesn't have to be a whole song, it can just be a couple of whatever.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you again so much for having me. This has been wonderful. If you are aspiring to be a performer or an entertainer, I hope that I can be this voice to you that go for it. Life is way too short to stick on the maybes and to stick on the, I don't know if I can do this. This is going to sound bad, but the worst thing that could happen is that you don't make it. And that sounds really hard, but you will learn so much about yourself along the way, and the memories and the hopefully fun, this should be fun if you're doing it, you need to have fun while you're doing it, will be worth it. And it will teach you at least something about yourself. And know that you define your success. Your mom can't define it for you. The lady down the street cannot define it for you. The news cannot define it for you. The internet, I don't know, a bug cannot define it for you. You get to decide what it means to be successful for yourself. And I guess we will sing a little bit of this is Tell Me on a Sunday from Song and Dance by Andrew Lloyd Webber. Thank you. Write a letter when you want to leave. Don't call me at 3 a.m. from a friend's apartment. I'd like to choose how I hear the news. Take me to a park that's covered with trees. Tell me on a Sunday, please. And we'll cut it there.
Bravo! Beautiful on the spot. Thank you so much, Meredith.
Thank you so much for having me, Lavender. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for that. Just almost brought me to tears. I feel like I really know you. So on that note, you guys, I want to thank you all for tuning in. And let's follow Meredith. We can follow her on IG. There it is there, MER.KillMartin. Please go to Instagram and follow her. Let's follow her journey. Let's follow her to Broadway. Let's just support her in any way that we can. You don't know how important a follow is to someone who's building a platform. So please do that. And I encourage you, Meredith, to get on TikTok. It's some crazy stuff on TikTok where people got 1 million views and 1 million followers.
I'm working on it. We're building it slowly. I'm just not the TikTok. And if I can leave the audience with just one thing. If you're ever wondering how you can support the arts, go see a show. doesn't matter what show it is, be it community theater, regional theater. It means so much to those performers that you are there. And I will bet you a nice painted rock that you will at least learn something about yourself. Maybe you won't love the show, but hopefully you will. And just know that what keeps the arts alive is you.
That's wonderful. Wonderful way to end. Support the arts and go see a show. All right, you guys, good night. And on that note, we want to ask you to go to the Other Woman Magazine Facebook page and like the Other Woman and support the Other Woman by sharing your story. We all have a story. If you're brave enough to peel back the layers, contact me and I can have you on. All right, you guys, good night.
Fake, be who you wanna be, 'cause what makes you unique is your identity. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity. It's your identity. Yeah. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity, it's your identity. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity, it's your identity. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's what makes up you and me. It's your identity, it's your identity.